Why am I looking at the... Hello, is anybody in there? Okay. It's following me, it's kind of creepy. She destroys planets, lots of them, but she did not destroy Earth. Why? Because they like our television. Wow, you keep it up, Hollywood, in that. It's the only reason we're not dead. Way to go. Boom.
Firstly, the moderating is one half of the three of us in the Movie Madhouse podcast. James will be doing the Q&A, and our special guest, none other than one half of the Royal Canadian Movie Podcast duo, but also the voice of Funtime Chica and Bon Bon from Five Nights at Freddy's. This is Becky Shrimpton.
Thanks, Rob. Thanks for organizing all this.
Oh, we're sitting. Okay.
I know. I'm going to hang out. How are you doing?
Just chill.
Yeah, I know. That's just how you got to be, right? It's like you got all these people wandering around. They're obviously doing really cool stuff. I mean, I keep seeing all these cosplayers like you with the wings. That is unbelievable. How long did it take you to do that?
Wow. I missed her on the way around.
Months. I am very impressed. Well done. That's super cool. I saw a Shredder walk around, and I was like, I was Shredder in, like, I think third grade for Halloween, and I did not look half so good. You got to pick the comfortable cosplay. It looks great.
Well, there's Wonder Woman. I swear to God, she was Poison Ivy last year.
She looks amazing.
She does.
Man.
Captain Marvel is around.
There's the Splinter. Oh, you look so great, man.
Oh.
I'm so into it. Ugh. Amazing.
So, it's very nice to meet you.
It's nice to meet you too, James. I love the Movie Madhouse podcast. It is mad.
And the Royal Canadian Movie Podcast, of which I've sampled a little bit of.
Excellent. And which episode did you listen to?
The one with my co-host, Rob Bellamy, who guested on your episode. I can't remember the name of your co-host.
My co-host is Mr. Cameron Maitland.
Yes. Okay.
Yes.
So I'm going to be listening to far more of those in the future. I tried my best to do a bit of research.
I appreciate that. Thank you.
And aside from just talking about the podcast, you're also, a fairly prolific voice actress?
Yeah, I do a reasonable amount of stuff.
Okay. There was one in particular I had to ask you about, because I've only heard about this every once in a while, never taking the time to look it up, and it's like, oh, this sounds like a nice friendly thing. Five Nights at Freddy's.
Oh, it's very friendly.
Oh,
you
yes.
know, people just want to scoop you out and be inside you and be like as close to you as possible.
Well, you think, say, you hear the name Nightmare on Elm Street, you hear Silent Hill, it's all this ominous. So Five Nights at Freddy's, oh, that sounds fun.
Great. Yeah, it's a bunch of these fuzzy animatronics that just want to be your best friend, that come alive at night and want to destroy you. It's awesome. And the entire time, you're trying to hide from them. And I think what I love so much about it is that there's no gore. It's just all atmosphere, and it just builds and builds and builds and builds. And you're like, I don't want to do this. I don't want to go to bed. I don't want to be alone. I don't like it.
See, now you've got me intrigued, because the only Silent Hill, The Room, I think, was the first Silent Hill game I played, and the first video game to creep me out.
You know, my sister and I used to play Silent Hill, and we used to play Silent Hill 2 was our big one, and that one, especially because, like, there's no health meter, like, the thing just vibrates more and more as you get, like, more and more deathly. And it's the same thing with Five Nights has that, like, incredible build of, like, you don't know what's going to happen until all of a sudden you get jump scared and you're dead, right? That's game over.
Yeah, and then sometimes it can just freak you out with the music. Like, I had Silent Hill 3, and it came with the soundtrack. And I was just in the office at work one day, and one of my coworkers came in, and I knew he was a Silent Hill fan. I started playing the soundtrack. He's like, no, leaves the office.
Well, it's all atmosphere. I think that atmosphere is so hard to build and so hard to create, and it's really a credit to the creator of the game. I mean, Scott Cawthorn does everything. Like, he builds the music, he builds the worlds, he makes the characters, and, like, the lore, like with Silent Hill, right? I mean, they've got two movies based on that, which we've covered on the Royal Canadian Movie Podcast, because they're Canadian movies. I don't know if you
knew
that.
Which I'm getting to soon.
Oh, you've got, okay, you'll get there.
Yeah.
You'll get there. But it's just building of these worlds and these incredible lore, and that's where the best fandoms come from, is when there's this whole world built around this character and this these people that you have to interact with and have to survive within, right?
Right. And this was, I looked it up, and the one you're part of, you do Bon Bon and, sorry, is it Chiquita?
Fun Time Chica. So I'm actually in two.
Fun Time Chica.
Yeah, so I'm in Sister Location, and I'm in Ultimate Custom Night, are the two
different
ones.
Now the sister one, I heard, is the fifth game in the series?
That's correct, yep.
So, and you said, what was the name of the other one?
Ultimate Custom Night.
Ultimate, and now which number is that? Is that after it?
That's after it, yes. That's number seven.
Number seven.
Yeah. And then they're on to the VR one next. So, like, these worlds just keep building. There's a movie coming.
Put yourself in the scariest location possible.
Exactly. There's a movie coming
Christopher
Columbus
that.
Is writing and directing it right now. So
yeah, the
Mr.
nice guy
Harry
who
Potter.
Did Home Alone and Harry Potter is going to scare the hell out of you.
Exactly. And Scott Cawthorn's, again, like, he's so into the world building and he's so hands-on that he's rejected all the scripts so far because he's like, this isn't it. You need to make sure that it's the world. So I love that he's telling Christopher Columbus what to do.
And you get very rare properties where that happens, where there was an infamous situation with Clive Cussler about the movie Sahara.
Yes.
And lawsuits abound. But I've also heard other ones where the creator is just like, no, you're, Frank Miller.
Yes, Frank Miller's totally one. Yeah.
Sin City finally let it go for Robert Rodriguez because he seduced him and he convinced him that he could do it, and he did it.
Yeah.
Twice.
Well, Alan Moore is the same way, right? Like, how many of Alan Moore's properties have been bought, and you're like...
He just... I never understood how he continued to allow people to make them. You do it and don't mention my name.
I think that's probably part of it, and I think part of it too is that when he wrote for everything, he was probably writing in ways that he wasn't owning the properties. Like the properties were going to whoever the publisher was, so he didn't have that right of refusal.
But they would still associate him with the property, and he's like, no, thank you.
Exactly, because it's his, right? Alan Moore's League of Extraordinary Gentlemen, Alan Moore's Watchmen, Alan Moore's From Hell,
V for Vendetta.
V for Vendetta
League
is not
of Extraordinary
a bad movie.
Gentlemen. Exactly. The list goes on and on and on.
Just keeps happening, totally. But I think that's one of the things I love about Scott is that he's smart enough to know the value of his property and know that because he's kind of the solo artist, that he's the one who really knows. He's the keeper of the lore, right? So people will check in and there's the whole conversations about what's canon, what's not canon, what's in the fandom. And he knows what that is. So he knows exactly what the world is.
He knows the value of it, exactly. Because if he lets it go... Well, I think I see my boss wandering around. if he lets the property go and they make a mess of it, that kind of puts a black mark on the property and it would reflect poorly on him.
I think that's part of it, but I think there's just... Five Nights at Freddy's really has a life of its own. Like, you see how many incredible... And all the best properties do. Like, Star Wars has a life of its own. Star Trek has a life of its own. They all have these... where people have, like, taken the stories and they really run with them. And the same thing happens with Five Nights at Freddy's. Is people make these amazing fan games. They make incredible fan art. They make stories. They make all these other spin-offs and properties.
I didn't mean to cut you off there.
No, of
and
course.
This one's a mobile app
for
your phone. So who doesn't have one?
Exactly. So it makes it accessible. It makes it fun. And again, because every one kind of builds on the last one and you're seeing all this building that people can kind of take into their own hands. So it feels like they're part of the process.
Okay. It does. Oh, okay. Sorry.
Hi, welcome back.
Mesmerized. No. I just wanted to... I don't want to get too far into Five Nights at Freddy's, even though it's probably one of the more intriguing projects you're involved in.
It's pretty cool. Yeah.
I wanted to bring it back to the podcast, but first,
totally.
there was a few projects that you were involved with that I wanted to. Let me see. Children's TV Fireman Sam.
Fireman Sam. That's one of my favorites.
Now, like, I don't have kids.
No.
My brothers and sisters have kids. Some of them.
You've been cut off. Do you want to borrow my mic?
I cut myself off.
Oh, okay.
I'm going to turn the mic around this way.
Go home, you drunk.
dramatic tension. No, because all the kids are fans of PJ Masks and Paw Patrol. I had never heard of Fireman Sam. There's no reason I would have, but... You did several episodes.
I'm two of the main characters on it.
Two of the main characters.
Yeah, I'm Penny Morris, who's the main, one of the main firefighters, and I'm Helen Flood, who's the nurse on the show. And I'm in the U.S. version. There's a U.K. and a U.S. version. I'm on the U.S. version.
Do you do accents?
And I do an accent in one of them. It's not very good, but I do an accent. But something I really love about that show, and I don't know, you haven't seen it, but it's very self-aware and it's very funny. So it's this tiny little town, like a coastal town, and like everything's always catching fire. People are always getting stuck in trees and they're hanging off cliffs, but they're so aware that that keeps happening. So they're like, well, your house keeps burning down so often. I'm glad I'm installing this new fire alarm. Like,
there's no recurring character that drives by and goes, move.
Exactly. But it's very self-aware and it's very fun. But what I love is that we start every episode. We get Skyped in with the director from the UK, and the director always tells us a story from the Facebook page about a kid who has, you know, saved their whole family or saved their next door neighbor or done something because they watched a Fireman Sam episode. And we're like, oh, I know what to do in an emergency now because I watched one of the characters from Fireman Sam do it. And then you start everything just bawling uncontrollably. Oh. And you're just like, oh man, these kids are so great. And you're sobbing. And then you have to chill and then go do an episode of Fireman Sam, right? But
I have to get all happy again.
Exactly. It's great. But yeah, just hearing that, because you don't think about that, right? You're just like, I'm having fun. I get to go to work and have a great time, and I get to entertain people. And then you're like, oh, kids are actually learning something from what I'm doing, and they're potentially saving lives or saving their homes or whatever. And that's the coolest.
Right.
Yeah.
Is there anything... Like, how did you first get into voice acting?
I started out as a stage actor, so I did a lot of theater and stuff living out in Vancouver. I've lived in a bunch of places. And then I just decided that this was something I really loved doing. Like, I've always loved anime, and I've always loved animation. Like, that's always been a big thing for me. My dad's an illustrator, and we always grew up watching, like, obviously all the Disney stuff, but like he liked the really weird stuff that was like from all over the place in the 80s when animation was really weird, and especially the dark stuff. And so when I started to kind of plan my career as an actor, I was like, you know, I think I want to do voiceover. I think I love the idea of like making these characters come to life using just my voice and just limited skills. And then you start to do it and you realize, oh, this isn't just my voice. This is my whole body and I'm having to put everything into this. Just the only thing you're hearing is my voice.
Well, I've seen you see behind the scenes on several movies and you watch the voice acting sessions and like regardless of what it looks like in the finished product, they're doing all sorts
of
stuff.
You're exhausted by the end of it. So I don't know. I'm going to tell a Tom Hanks story. Can I tell Tom Hanks' story?
Please do.
Okay, I will. So Tom Hanks has this great story about working on Toy Story, and that when he's doing the Woody character, you know, he's got his what's going on? And he's doing that, and you're doing it over and over again. And you can't hear what's happening on the other side of the booth, but there's like 15 producers, and they're all standing there. And they all kind of like look at each other and sort of like nod, or they'll shake their head. They'll be like, you know, and you can't hear them. You just see them do that. And you're like, oh, was that good? Was that bad? Are you going to make me do it another 15 times? And they're like, well, you could be a little more, zoom, like a little more zoom. Can you give me more zoom? And so you have to like do it again. So by the end of the day, you're just like, I have just had a full workout and you're totally
well,
gross.
Yeah, but I suppose, how can you really get all that across by just standing here doing this?
Yeah, and you can't because it's your whole body. And especially if you're playing a character, you know, who has a hunch, or you have a character who's got like, you know, really big lips or like a really big ears or something, or they have a hunch, it's going to change how your voice changes, right?
Right.
So like if I have a character with a hunch who kind of speaks out the side of their mouth, you know, like an Igor-y sort of character, then I'm going to do that and it's going to change everything in my performance, right? Like, and that's where if I was doing that like this, it's not quite the same.
No, and you... You're not exactly... It would help to get into character, I suppose.
Exactly. That's just it. Because you have to become that thing. And you really can't hear what it is. The best piece of advice I have for people who want to learn how to do animation is tell the artists what to draw. Tell them what you're doing, right? Like, if I'm jumping up and down, I should be jumping up and down. You know? Like, it gives it that different vocal tone.
Gets it in your voice as the performance.
Exactly. So then you're telling the artist, oh, they're jumping, and so now I have to make sure that they're jumping within the frame, right?
Right. Now, in addition to your voice acting, you have done some, I guess it's just called acting then.
It is called acting. Yes. With my whole body.
There was only a lot of them, I admit, I hadn't heard of.
Totally fair.
There was a short that just jumped out at me. Call Girl of Cthulhu.
Oh, Call Girl of Cthulhu. Yeah.
And I saw it, forgive me, most of my research would have been derived from IMDb.
No, totally cool.
Because I looked up and it said, Call Girl of Cthulhu, and it was a short, not to be confused with Call Girl of Cthulhu.
Which is a feature, I genuinely have no idea how that happened. That's one of those weird universal things. No, Call Girl of Cthulhu was, a friend of mine wrote it, and she's very... into ideas of, you know, body positivity and, you know, different communities and fandoms and stuff. So she asked if I would do it, and I wasn't doing anything, and I said, okay. So that's why that's on my IMDb. I think that's definitely my most interesting IMDb credit.
Well, the title just jumps out at you. Yes. The other one was Surviving Evil.
Oh, yeah, Surviving Evil. That was fun.
A cheery subject.
Yes, very cheery subject. And that was, I think, one of the hardest things I've ever done. It's content is, like, not exactly family-friendly,
no.
But it's hosted by Charisma Carpenter from Buffy the Vampire Slayer,
right.
Which is very cool. But, yeah, in that one, actually, it's... if you want to watch really terrible things happen to me, like, for like a good half hour, it's true crime. Yeah,
right.
But the good thing about that show, like Fireman Sam, but for adults, is that it's people who survived incredibly challenging situations, whether it was like a kidnapping or an assault. There, in one of them, a guy ends up in a tree shredder and like had to like rescue himself after losing his limbs in a tree shredder. So,
oh my goodness.
I know. So like, it's not the funnest in terms of content, but it kind of shows you how people overcame incredibly difficult odds, and that's one of the reasons why I wanted to do it, because I was like, watching doom and gloomy stuff, even though I love horror movies, is not really something I want to be part of, but this was about how to overcome those things.
Yes, the personal tragedies. And exactly. I had read that the very first episode was Charisma Carpenter herself.
That's right, yeah. She had an incident in her life, which was terrifying.
Did you get to meet her or interact with her at all?
I did not. She does everything in L.A.
Be just like a studio introducing everything?
Exactly. But I did talk to the producer about her, because I was like, oh, man, because I'm the biggest Buffy fan, right? Like, I love that show. And I was like, I'm on the same show. I'm now tangentially linked to Charisma Carpenter on the IMDb in perpetuity. She can't do anything about it.
That is pretty awesome.
Exactly.
And it's bringing me back to a happy note.
Exactly.
Okay. Digging a little deeper into your main focus, Royal Canadian Movie Podcast.
Yes.
If it is indeed your main focus.
You know what? It's becoming my main focus, because it's something not a lot of people talk about. Did you guys know that Canada makes movies? Were you aware of this? Because, it's one of those things when you tell people, you're like, oh, yeah, I run a podcast of Canadian movies. They're like, oh, so you talk about Porky's and that's it? And it's like, no, we have such an incredible like homegrown film industry, and we have so many amazing movies. I have now seen every David Cronenberg movie ever made. It came to me and to my co-host. I was training in England, and I was training with a bunch of kids who were from the States and were from England at like very high levels.
Right.
And they were also like, Canada doesn't have a film industry. And I was like, yeah, we do. And then I could not name a single one. And that was really embarrassing. So I said, okay, that's never going to happen again. And we need to find a way to make this work. So what we do on the podcast is we invite on industry insiders and industry experts. And they pick their favorite Canadian film. And that also helps us find stuff we've never heard of before. And they can pull stuff that's very obscure, but like incredible. Like there's a movie from John Pays called Crime Wave from Winnipeg. John Pays, if you like The Kids in the Hall, this guy directed all of The Kids in the Hall sketches, and he's like best friends with Bruce McCulloch, so it's exactly that kind of sense of humor and that silliness and weirdness, but it's in a movie and that I never would have found before, and it's awesome, and it's actually the movie that got him the gig to do Kids in the Hall.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, so you're finding this stuff. I just talked to, the episode's coming out in 2 weeks, Ted Kotcheff. Who,
oh, really?
Yeah, who directed the original Rambo First Blood, who directed The Apprenticeship of Jenny Kravitz, which is what we talk about, which is incredible. Wake and Fright, which is so good. He directed Weekend at Bernie's. This guy is amazing, and like his stories are incredible. And hearing him talk about working in Canada, he gave Richard Dreyfuss his big leading break. He wouldn't have had Jaws or Close Encounters if he hadn't have done Duddy Kravitz.
Oh my
so
goodness.
You're seeing the influence of Canadian film all the way through.
And I'd gone down the list, and I think this one was fairly recent. You spoke with Peter Outerbridge.
Oh, Peter Outerbridge is so much fun. Have you seen Level 16?
I have not seen Level 16.
Dude.
But
dude.
One of my favorite Canadian movies is Men with Brooms.
Yes. Okay, we talked about that one earlier, too. Yeah.
I'm like, oh, she ever gets Paul Gross on the show?
We're actually working on that right now.
But you
now.
Did talk with, because I think I downloaded the episode because I wanted to hear if you asked anything about Men with Brooms.
I haven't yet. We're actually talking to Peter again to see if we can get him on, because he, in the episode we did with him, talking about his film Level 16, which if you guys like sci-fi, man, that movie is so good. And like, you think it's going one way and it's going somewhere
and
totally
it's a recent
different.
Film.
It came out last year. It was just in theaters. I think it just came out on VOD, and he plays the doctor in that. It's, if you like Handmaid's Tale, it's Handmaid's Tale-esque, but it doesn't go in the same direction. It's easier to swallow, but it's still creepy and wonderful. Very post-apocalyptic.
I still think back to his episode of the Outer Limits.
Yeah, he's the best. He's the best. And talking to him, he's just like the nicest man, and you're like, this is so cool. But yeah, Level 16 is awesome, and he's great in it.
Okay. The one you mentioned that is coming out soon, Ted Kotcheff?
Yes, so that one's coming out soon, and we talk about Jenny Kravitz in that one.
What number will that be? It was just a roundabout way of asking you how long you've been doing this podcast.
About 2.5 years now.
Yeah.
So that one's pretty good. And so I think that'll be episode 140. There's some episodes I think I'm more proud of than others. So one of the things I really love is that when you get people on who have, like, specific points of view. So have you seen the movie Goon?
Oh, yes.
Yeah, Goon is the best. We got Aurora Brown from Baroness von Sketch on to talk about Goon. And, like, we fangirled out because it's one of my favorite Canadian movies. That movie is brutal and the best and so much fun. And she talks about the editing and how you edit for comedy and how that movie is almost entirely reliant, and it's as good as it is and as funny as it is because of the edit. And she's able to break it down. And she's hilarious. Baroness von Sketch is great. But she explains it in this way that you're just like, where did this come from? And then we had Paul Zaza on, whose name may not be familiar, but you have heard his work.
That's vaguely familiar there.
He has scored all of Bob Clark's movies. So he scored A Christmas Story. He scored...
Black Christmas.
Nope, that's Carl Zitterer. Look at me knowing this. you didn't know, but he did My Bloody Valentine. And a bunch of other stuff. His stories of Bob Clark are unbelievable, and because he just doesn't care at this point. So he's like, everyone's dead. I'm just going to tell a bunch of stories. So you're hearing stories about Peter Simpson, who produced all of the Prom Night movies, and all these incredible stories about him having to, like...
Because you did Hello, Mary Lou Prom Night, too, didn't you?
He did Prom Night, too.
No, but
Hello.
You profiled it on one of your episodes.
We did. We talked to Mark Little from Cavendish and Picnic Face for that one. Mark Little is one of the funniest men alive. And again, that episode's one of our best because, Prom Night 2 is mind-bogglingly weird in the best possible way. I think that might be on my list of favorite Canadian films.
I remember it being so creepy when I was younger.
Because it is. That horse with a tongue. You're like, horse with a tongue. This is insane. But it's the best.
How did you get your podcast off the ground, though?
Well, I wanted a podcast, and my friend, so my co-host Cam Maitland is one of the movie experts for the TV channel Hollywood Suite, and he went to film school, and like his knowledge of film is encyclopedic. Like he knows so much and so many different things and all the different styles and stuff, and I'm definitely more, like I have a passion for it and I love it, but I'm not as like deep into the technicalities as he is. So the two of us were like, well, I want a podcast. Do you want to do this thing with me? So we just created it. And then we have, because we're both in the industry, we were like, well, we have friends who will come
contacts.
Hang out with us. And it just started out, and I think all the best podcasts just start out as having fun with your friends and making something, talking about something you genuinely love for half an hour, right?
Oh,
and
exactly.
Just cutting yourself off at half an hour is
and
the issue.
And if you disagree, it's even better.
Exactly. And then that led me doing a new podcast called AI Meets World for... Microsoft and the Globe and Mail.
And AI Meets World. Okay.
Yeah, and that one's super fun. So that one talks about how pop culture has influenced artificial intelligence and development of it, as well as what new innovations are happening that are going to change our lives in artificial intelligence. It's pretty cool.
Okay.
But it becomes that involved thing. And then when you start to get the online community going and people are having conversations, like I got an email from a guy from Brazil the other day wanting to talk about Cronenberg's Crash. And he was like, I thought I was the only one who'd seen this movie. And I was like, well, it's a special one. It's interesting that like you're engaging these people from all over the world who want to talk about these things, who want to celebrate these things. And with our show specifically, we deal with positivity. We don't ever tear down movies. We'll thoughtfully critique them, being like, I don't know how I felt about this moment, but we will never tear down a movie. And we've deliberately said if none of us can agree that it's a film that we really want to highlight or profile, we just don't do it, because I think there's just so much negativity out there that there's no point. You should be celebrating these things. There's so much good that it's like, let's just have fun. This is great.
Exactly. And because not every movie is for everyone.
Exactly.
And I railed against Gravity for years. I was like, I hate this movie so much.
But it's not about you, right?
No.
Yeah, there's
no.
Lots of people love it.
It wasn't for me. I mean, but then I look at, there's aspects of the movie that I find very impressive. There were just other aspects that turned me off. But I like get into disputes on the podcast about how I had mentioned, well, this movie is better than this one, and they go and they shut my mic off. They turn it back on, but
but it's that thing. So like, for example, I have a guest coming on Monday, and we're talking about I'm gonna mispronounce this, feel terrible, Aranjuez the Fast Runner. Are you familiar with this?
It's the Fast Runner?
The Fast Runner. Aranjuat, the Fast Runner.
Oh, and
yes. I always mispronounce it.
It's the
it's Inuit.
Anatariwat?
I know. I'm going to have to learn it before Monday. I feel so
because
bad.
Because it came out when I was working at a video store.
It's incredible, and it's 3 hours long, and it's very slow, but it's like nothing I've ever seen before, and it's understanding that, this isn't for me, this is for, and I'm glad I saw it, but this is very much for indigenous people to see what life was like, so people can watch it.
I think it swept the Genie Awards, didn't it?
It swept the Genies. It is the first film to win the Camera d'Or at Cannes. It did incredibly well.
Oh, that's right.
It is beautiful. It's beautiful and incredible, and it's based on a folk tale, and it's like, it's brutal and awesome, and I liked it very much, but it's so different from what I'm used to seeing, and I think having that experience in, like, because I never would have watched that movie on my own, but having someone say, hey, you're going to sit down for 3 minutes and watch a movie that's entirely in Inuit language, I'm like, yes, I am, and this is great. But it's also understanding that not every movie is made for me as the ideal audience in mind, right?
No, that's true, and like, because I was aware of the movie, and I did take it home the night before it came out or whatever, and I couldn't get into it. I didn't give it a fair shake.
It's a movie I also think needs to be watched in a theater because it's the way it's shot and it's so immersive and the music and the sound and the lighting. Like, there's some movies that I think just do better in theaters. Like, when you're watching
Like
The Revenant, or like you're watching a movie like any of the Marvel Universe movies, I have to watch those in theaters because they're so big and there's so much going on that you don't want to miss any of it, and it's so immersive. When you're watching Captain Marvel like fly in and do their thing, it just feels so much better to do that than sitting and watching it on a tablet or watching it on a screen on a plane or something, right? You're like, yes, I'm there and I'm watching this.
Yes. Yeah. And like, I'll admit there are some of the Marvel ones that I do miss in the theaters just because I can't.
You can't see them all.
You can't see them all, but I also, like, I'm spending all my time at the movie theater because I work in one. Then I'm going to go home, and I'm like, oh, I don't want to come back on my day off. Yeah. I had to for Avengers last night, but...
Well, obviously, otherwise everyone's going to tell you about it. I get it.
Well, I'm going to tell myself about it. I kept ducking in there every 5 minutes. Like, I have to stop and just watch the movie. Need to support the Canadian content.
Do support... Well, and it's not just... I think... This is the thing that I've kind of learned as we've been going along and doing the show, is that there is such a weird stigma Canadians have about watching Canadian film. And they're like, oh, it's Canadian. It's got to be boring about people who live in North Bay. And, you know, some of them are, and those movies are actually really good. But there's just such a wide, eclectic range of things. And there's some movies that are Canadian that you wouldn't realize are Canadian, like Mean Girls is Canadian.
No, see, I wasn't aware of that.
Exactly.
One.
And you're like, how did that happen? And so I think more of an understanding that there's just so much more. And I mean, distributors honestly don't do a great job of, like, because Canadian films really only get a week in theater run if you're lucky. But
oh, yeah. It's like foreign films where... Oh, okay. He just gave me a countdown.
Oh, perfect. Okay. I know. I'm very entertaining. I can't help
because
it.
Because most of the Canadian films won't get... You're just too interesting.
I know.
They don't get much of a release.
But with streaming, that's what's really going to save the Canadian film industry, because Americans love our films, especially our horror. Like, again, check out Level 16. I cannot recommend it enough. It's so good, and the twist is so amazing.
The interior, which you mentioned earlier.
Oh, yes, the interior. Trevor Juris is the interior. This is a movie I never would have found if it hadn't have been for the podcast, and it's one of the creepiest, weirdest things I think I've ever seen, but I love horror movies. I don't get nightmares. This thing upset me to my core.
Like, I never would have heard of Black Fawn Films if it hadn't been for Rob and Jason and the podcast.
Exactly, and so it's making sure, and like the beauty of streaming, the beauty of podcasts is, like, this is the stuff that we can find, and and like I said, the Paul Zaza episode is awesome. The Ted Kotcheff episode that's coming out, I'm so proud of. His stories are unbelievable. And
Also is surprising that how many of the Hollywood actors that you see in just the big budget movies actually appear in some of the small Canadian films. Because there's one that, it's called Small Town Murder Songs,
yes.
Which I have. It's been sitting in front of my TV for years. And it's got Peter... Oh, see, this is where my mind draws up. Peter Stormare.
Yes. Oh, Peter Stormare was around here for a while. There's a bunch of people that just like being here. Danny Glover does a ton of stuff up here. He loves being here. There's some people that just have homes in Muskoka.
And Kurt Russell and Goldie Hawn.
Kurt Russell and Goldie Hawn live in Muskoka, right? So you just give them a call and you go, Kurt Russell is in a heist movie that we just covered called The Art of the Steal with Jay Baruchel.
That's another one I downloaded. I love that movie.
Totally. So, like, we have all these movies that have these A-list actors, but and that's been going on for a while. Have you seen The Silent Partner?
Silent partner.
Dude, the silent partner. Oh, man. The guy who wrote L.A. Confidential.
Okay.
And all these, like, massive, Curtis Hanson, I think that's the name.
Well, the late Curtis Hanson, yes.
He has this unbelievable heist movie. It's a cat and mouse heist movie with Elliot Gould and Christopher Plummer.
It must have been in one of his early movies.
It's in the
then.
70s. It's 78. I want to say 78.
Oh, yeah, because he wasn't like a named director until about L.A. Confidential.
But you wouldn't have L.A. Confidential if you don't have the silent partner. And it's John Candy's first feature film, and he's awesome in it.
John Candy?
He's in a serious role, and it's amazing. I cannot recommend that movie enough, The Silent Partner. I think it just got a re-release. It's so good.
Silent Partner. Well, I'm going to make a note of that one, too, and The Interior.
And The Interior. The Interior is great. Yeah, all of it's good, man. Crime Wave, can't recommend that one enough. Everyone's like, what's your favorite Canadian film? And I honestly can't say anymore. Like, we've seen so many incredible ones.
Well, Men with Brooms and Hyena Road are at the top, probably at the top for me. Paul Gross is just a phenomenal actor and director.
You love him, and I get it, man. He's a Canadian national treasure.
Bad cop.
I hate that movie so much. I know so many people love it, but it's just not my thing.
And The Sweet Hereafter.
The Sweet Hereafter is unbelievable. Oh, man.
Adam McGoyan.
Yeah. Well, thank you. This was such a pleasure.
This was awesome.
I can't wait to chat with you here soon on the podcast. It's going to be awesome.
Yes.
Yes.
All right. Will you have fun with the rest of the con?
I will. I'm excited to meet everybody.
I'm now thinking of the questions I wanted to ask you but forgot.
That happened. Come on over and we'll chat later, James. That'll
I
be
will.
Glorious.
Yes. I will.
Yay. And right. If anyone has any questions and want to come say hi, highs are always free, and I love meeting new people. I'll be sitting over there.
All right. Enjoy yourselves.
Yes. Thanks, guys.
This time, one of the members of the Movie Madhouse doing it will be me. You're stuck with me. And our Q&A celebrity for this time is none other than famous from Stargate Atlantis, The Flash, Leo-nominated The Flash, Paul McGillion.
I took your mic.
Story it. Perfect. Hello. How are you all? Good. Good. Lovely. It's lovely to be here. It's fantastic to be here in Chatham. Everyone's so great, all the volunteers, Rob, the committee, thanks for having me. It's so nice to be here, and of course, all you guys. So great to be here. There's my friends, the Klingons, over there. Kapow!
Yes.
Yeah. Something like that.
We've been learning Klingon this weekend.
Don't. They might drink my blood or something. Creepy.
So, everybody here obviously is familiar with Paul. What are you most familiar about Paul with? We're interviewing the crowd.
Like, I don't know if that was worded correctly.
Yes. Wait, maybe not. Yes. Well, I know I first introduced to you through Stargate Atlantis.
Yes.
The lovable Carson Beckett.
The lovely cheeky doctor. Thank
yes.
you very much.
But now you've done so much more.
I have done some stuff, yeah.
What is one of the key things that you've looked back at and go, you know what, if I could do that every day, I would be a happy guy?
Well, you know, Stargate was so much fun because I also kind of equate it to like playing cops or robbers in space. You know, is that kind of thing. Yeah, every week you're going through the gate and you go through a different dimension into a different universe and you never know what you're going to get. So it's just one of those fun jobs, you know. Got to do the Scottish accent, which is always fun. Didn't get a love interest, which wasn't so fun, but maybe at some point in time.
Well, you do that Scottish accent very well.
Thank you.
Is that learned?
Well, my parents, I was born in Scotland, and I'm one of seven kids, and most of us are born in Ireland and Scotland, and my younger brother's born in Canada. So my parents have a very thick Scottish accent, and no problem for Dr. Beckett as well. Thank you very much.
Something you just hear in the back of your head
yes.
every day.
All the time, yes.
Kind of like, because I imagine when you landed Stargate, like you were excited, right? No doubt.
Well, my parents, when I first started acting, you know, my dad, you know, I have a teaching degree, and he's like, you're a teacher, teach for God's sakes. What kind of game you're playing with this acting? And, you know, then he called me up, and I started getting parts on shows and things, and I got a part on The X-Files. And he says, you know, on The X-Files? I said, yeah. He goes, that's fantastic. That's a popular show. How much do you make doing that? And I told him, and he goes, that's great. The acting's fantastic. Love it. And then when I'd call, you know, I start calling home and stuff like that, and eventually they got more of the lingo down, and he said, Janet, it's Paul. It's Mike Paul on the phone. Any gigs? You have any acting gigs? I said, oh, yeah. And when I got Stargate, I said, I'm playing a doctor. Oh, you're playing a doctor. Very nice. Janet, we have a doctor in the house. Oh, that's fantastic. That's great. What is it? I said, Stargate. What? Stargate. What? Stargate. Star Trek. I said, no, Stargate. Star Trek. I said, no, Stargate. Star Trek. I go, no, Stargate. Stargate. It's not bloody Stargate. It's Star Trek. I've been watching it for years. I said, it's not. I don't raise your voice to your old man. Here's your mom. My mom comes on the phone. Are you on the Star Trek? Yes. Yes, I am.
So they watch Star Trek every week? Were they big Star Trek fans once you started?
The Star Trek fans, yes, exactly.
Yes.
So they eventually get the idea that I was on Stargate. But then I ended up being in Star Trek in the movie, a little brief pop in J.J. Abrams' Star Trek film. And he says, you know, I said, I'm in the Star, I got a part in the Star Trek film. Stargate. I go, no, Star Trek.
It's like, oh, here we go. Now, oh my God, I had a brain fart. I am so
brain
sorry.
Brain free. He's got a lot of stuff on his mind here.
Yes. With Stargate Atlantis, I know it was an ensemble cast.
Yes.
Like, you guys, just from watching, seemed to get along very, very well.
We did. Yeah, we had a great cast. You know, Joe Flanagan, David Hewlett, fantastic, and Rachel Luttrell, Tori Higginson, and that little guy, Jason Momoa. Yeah.
Yes, that little guy.
The little bug.
I heard a very interesting story about you and Jason.
What?
Something about wrestling.
Yes, yes. We end up wrestling one.
Listen to this very carefully.
We would go out sometimes, and Joe Flanagan and myself and Jason would go out, and I wrestled all through, you know, college and stuff. And we're all messing around one night, and we wrestled a little bit, and I got kind of Jason in a bit of a choke lock, and he kind of tapped out, and then, you know, luckily, because he would just squash me like a bug, you know, he's a giant. And then Joe and I ended up wrestling, and Joe wouldn't let up. And the next day, I walk into the trailer, and he kind of walks into the trailer's next door and goes, Paul, you're strong, but I didn't tap. I go, yeah, you did. No, I didn't. So, yeah. Let me just preface that with Jason would squash me. And I'm so happy for him. He's killing it right now. He's doing such great.
Yeah, amazing. He's
amazing.
On fire.
He's a great guy. Deserves everything.
That is awesome.
It's true.
So now, I also know you from independent film.
Yes.
Because you did a really good independent film called Hello, Destroyer.
Yes. If anybody have a chance to see that, Hello, Destroyer. It's a very poignant film by Kevin Funk. He's a young Canadian filmmaker. It premiered at the Toronto Film Festival. It got critically acclaimed. I think it was runner-up best film at the Toronto Film Festival. It's won multiple awards. Jared Abrahamson plays his kid. He's a hockey player. And basically, it shows about how, you know, the institutionalization of violence in sports. And he has this incident where he accidentally injures a player on the opposite team. And it shows how his life just is affected by this one moment in time. And it was a very poignant film, and I think really great for a lot of young. It crosses over not just hockey, but sports in general. And it's a dark film, but it's really well done. You've seen it several times, right?
Oh, I have. And it's actually an interesting connection between Becky Shrimpton, who's here.
Yeah.
She is one half of the Royal Canadian Movie Podcast, which takes in Canadian film, and then they bring someone on and talk about it. So
nice.
Being part of the Movie Madhouse, they invited me on to the show and said, what movie do you want to talk about? I chose Hello, Destroyer.
Awesome.
So her particular episode with me of
the movie podcast
is about your movie.
I play the lead character's father, and he's a very kind of stern character. He doesn't really give a lot, and there's not a lot of communication happening, which is part of the problem in the whole environment of the film. And it's like silence is almost a character in the movie. You know, it's just if you get a chance to see it, it's on the Canadian film circuit. It's quite a special film.
Oh, it absolutely is. And it's a little deceiving if you do look at the cover, because it looks like a hockey movie, and it is hockey.
Yeah.
But that is just a background character. The movie itself is amazing. It really is. So now,
thank you.
Are there other independent films like that you're proud of?
Yeah, I did a film years ago called See Grace Fly about schizophrenia. My sister in the movie, played by Gina Shirelli, is a paranoid schizophrenic. And it really brings that, you know, mental illness to light. You know, it's a film we did about 15 years ago, and it played the circuits. But, you know, we started playing it again and bringing it back and forth. It's a beautiful film. She's wonderful in it. And I co-produced that with Gina Shirelli and Pete McCormick, who also wrote a hockey book called Understanding Ken. And he's a really great, great guy and a great writer and a great director.
Excellent. So now you said you produced that.
I produce that as well, yeah.
So you're not just an in-front-of-the-camera kind of person?
Not just a pretty face.
Look at this.
I don't even know about the pretty face, but yeah, I co-produced that, and I've done a few other shorts that I've co-produced, and did a few other things like that, and working on a script right now with a friend of mine, so it's good.
Very nice.
Yeah.
So, and this is going to be totally oddball. You go to a lot of these conventions.
Yes.
What are some of the, I want to say weirdest, but most interesting questions that you may have answered?
This is a good one. I was in, I did a convention in Germany, and sometimes when you go to the conventions, there's a lot of people there. Like, for example, in the talkback that we had, there would be 3,000 people in the crowd, right? This is a big, big convention called FedCon, and they ask the guests sometimes if you want to be a judge at the costume competition or the art show or something. And that particular time, I selected the art show. And you know Jewel State, she's on Firefly, she's on Star Trek. She was one of the guests, and Brent Spiner and Jonathan Frakes from Star Trek. And we're all going around, we're having a glass of wine. And these people make amazing things. Like they made these amazing, like Star Trek Enterprise made out of Lego. And you know, they're very talented, and all these things. And they have them covered in sheets, and they pull the sheets off. So we got up to one, and this lady says, this particular piece is very special because Paul McGillion is one of the judges today, and he has something to do with this. And everybody else is going, Paulie, they're giving me elbows. And I'm like, oh, that's awesome. And she pulls a sheet out, and it's a painting, and it's about this big. And it's amazing. It's cross-stitched, but it's myself and Joe Flanagan, both topless. And I'm like ripped. I have like a 12-pack, and he's holding me from behind like a wedding picture. And so when they pull it over, I'm having a sip of wine. I'm like, oh my God, you know? And she's like, do you like it? I said, well, I'm ripped. She goes, yes, Beckett's fit. I go, okay, well, thank you. But I go, but we're topless. She says, yes. And I said, and we're holding each other. She goes, yes. The comrades, they care for each other. I'm like, okay. So Joe Flanagan now has that in his bedroom.
That would be an interesting piece.
Yes.
So now, with these conventions, you go all over the world. I've
been all over the world, done these all over the world, yes.
What was one of the best countries to go to, not just for convention, but for environment?
It's been, Stargate's been a great thing because it's like the gift that keeps on giving you, having a chance to go around and meet all these wonderful people from all over the world. New Zealand was amazing. You know, I really love New Zealand and Australia. I'm going back there in August to do a convention. But, if you ever get a chance to go to New Zealand, I went to Hobbiton. You know, it's an amazing, beautiful country. Reminds me a lot of Canada in the lushness of it, the valleys. And that there's a reason they shot Lord of the Rings there, you know. It's just beautiful. That was amazing. I love going to the UK. I love going to Europe, you know, France, Germany, all of it. It's fun.
It's just fun traveling.
A lot of fun traveling, yeah, it's good.
Yes. But yet, you are based right in Canada.
Based in Canada, but I travel all over. Like last year, I did a film in India for 3 months, a dance movie called Heartbeats, with the same producer and director of Save the Last Dance and Step Up, and I'm the dad in it. Don't worry, I don't dance. Daddy don't dance. So you know, and that was a really cool experience. I was there for several. My wife got to come out and visit me for a little bit, but it's an amazing place to go to check out.
Really?
Yeah.
So if you had one magical place you could go and live just blissfully for the rest of your life?
I don't know. I mean, Hawaii's pretty nice.
Hawaii's very nice. Yeah, okay.
Yeah, went there on my honeymoon. That was nice.
Yeah, I can't argue that. Now, just while we're here, does anybody have any questions they would like to ask Paul? Because
any
we're
questions?
Here for you.
Please.
Fire away.
When I left Stargate and how I returned to Stargate, of course, he had to bring that up. with the episode Sunday, you know, I didn't know that was going to happen. And what was happening is that when I first started doing the show, I was a reoccurring character. And then the audience and the fan base really liked the character a lot. So they told me halfway through the first season, we're going to make you a regular on the show. I'm like, great. This is fantastic, you know. And then we went a few seasons and the character is really gaining popularity. And at one point in time, they said, listen, we want to do something different. We're going to kill off a major character, and it's going to be you. I was like, what? And so, you know, as an actor, you're like, oh, okay. Thought I was doing a great job. And, you know, and I, in the fan base, I thought, really thought as well. But, you know, listen, you do a show like that, you get an opportunity, and it's a great thing to do. And, you know, and you're thankful for it, and you move forward. So that was a difficult thing to do, but I understand why they're doing it, and there we go. But the fan base was really strong and supporting, so when Beckett died, there was a big backlash. They had like a, they had a basically a pipe band show up at the studios, and they had busloads of fans come off from all over, and all the girls had Save Carson on their underwear, and they flashed the studio with it, and it was on the CTV news, and I was in Los Angeles at the time. My brother called. He goes, there's a pipe band rally for you at Bridge Studios. I'm like, what? And it was quite amazing. They called it the Save Carson Beckett campaign. There was mugs and jackets and shirts and all, like honestly, baby bibs with Save Carson on it, like everything. And so, you know, eventually, a little while later, Joe Malazzi called me and said, would you be interested in coming back on the show? I'm like, I'm dead. And I goes, how are you going to do that? And he goes, well, you know, it's sci-fi. Anything can happen. And so clone Beckett comes back. So I was happy to come back, and it was strange coming back, but it was a really cool way to come back. And at the very last episode that we ever did of Atlantis, no spoilers here, Beckett flies Atlantis back to the bay in San Francisco. So it's kind of full circle for my character. It was pretty nice. And a lot of it to do with the fan base. You know, there's huge for me.
I'm going to jump in with a question. How does it feel to have that kind of reaction? Like you said, you accepted, okay, they want to write you off, you got to do it.
Yeah.
But to have the public come back that hard.
It was really flattering. You know, honestly, you don't expect that ever. You don't expect that a character you're playing a TV show, there's going to be like a, like I'm talking full-on bagpipes and drums and everything at the studio. You know, I'm like, what is going on here? So it's pretty flattering, you know, and humbling. You know, I got to be honest with you, it was pretty, like, pretty cool, you know, to have that. And thankful that it had that effect on people. It was nice.
That's awesome. Have you ever had the interest of doing another show style like that?
Pardon me?
Have you ever had interest to do another show that style?
Yeah, I mean, listen, that's a great show. The thing about Stargate that I really like is it's complete escapism. You know, people can go check out, watch it, and families watch it together. You know, I've been to conventions where I've seen kids that were like babies and now they're taller than me. You know, that I go to all over the world. And it's an amazing thing that brings families together. They watch the show together, you know. People said to me, where their mom was ailing or something, that was something that got them through, you know, got them through an illness. It's one of those shows that it has such a loyal, strong fan base. It's really special to be part of it. And I had no idea until I started doing it, you know.
And so now you're kind of dabbling in that with The Flash.
Yes, yeah, that's fun. I mean, The Flash, I play, it's a great character. Tom Cavanaugh is a very good friend of mine. He's the Reverse Flash on the show, and he's a great guy and an old friend of mine, another fellow Canadian, and an opportunity to come onto that show. We haven't had any scenes yet though, and it's the first time I played a Scottish character since Stargate actually, and he has a prosthetic belly and he's a very different than Beckett. His name's Earl Cox. He's a real kind of interesting character, so hopefully there'll be more of him in the next season.
And like you said, he just got nominated for a Leo for that role.
Yeah, that's the British Columbia Film and TV Awards, so it's a nice nice little nod to the character.
That is awesome.
Thank you.
Congratulations.
Buddy.
Is there any other questions?
Any questions? Nothing. You got nothing for me?
What?
Come on. You got nothing? Like the outfit, by the way. Very nice. There. Thank you. Yeah. Yeah. Yes. When I was on Sanctuary, which is another show, Amanda Tapping, oh my God, Jesus. That is one big Chewy right there. I think it's the biggest Chewy I've ever seen. I've seen a lot of Chewies. That's a big one.
He was here last year and he towered above everybody then.
No kidding. That's amazing. Sorry, back to your question. Yes, I played Terrence Wexford, and which is great because Beckett, when they killed Beckett off, it was like killing off a puppy. Terrence Wexford is like half lizard, half human. Just kind of an evil character and so great to play as an actor. It was a prosthetic piece that Todd Masters and his team did on my neck. They did do CGI when he kind of has venom that comes out. That was CGI, that aspect of it. But the whole piece was prosthetic and contacts and stuff. So that was a really, that was a cool one. Cool character to play. Evil.
Anything else?
Anyone else?
You know, like...
Pardon me? Have I done anything in Norway? No, I haven't. No, I love to go to Scandinavia. I've been to Scandinavia. When I in college, I went to Sweden and Denmark, but I'd never been to Norway. But a beautiful area. Love to. Yeah, throw me in a Viking show or something. Perfect. Thank you.
So you went through and you studied teaching.
I did an education degree, yeah.
What were you aiming for when you started that? Because you had a goal.
Well, you know, I just think, you know, at the time I was just, you know, I did an education degree and then I started acting, actually. And I wanted to, I got accepted to teach college. And I was kind of like, am I going to go? And I thought, you know, let me just get this so I have it and make my parents happy too, you know, at the same time. So I did that and I taught for a little while in Toronto, supply taught for a short period of time, and then was acting at the same time. And then the acting started picking up steam and I just kind of went, I got full-time teaching job offers and I said, no, I'm just going to pursue this. So I just kind of went with my guts and, you know, there you go.
That had to have been a tough decision. Because teaching is that full-time job, it's guaranteed.
Yeah. At the time, it really wasn't. I mean, it's kind of like, you know, I can always come back to it if I want. And then it just started rolling a little bit. And I'm like, this is the right decision. Because I really, and my parents weren't thrilled about it. You know, I don't think any parent at first is thrilled when the kids say they're going to be an actor. Because it's a tough business, right? But once I started getting some success and they started seeing, you know, be able to come back. And I think that calmed them a little bit. And you know, they're very happy for what I do now. My dad said, no matter what you do, make sure you're happy doing it. And I'm happy. So, yeah, it's good.
Excellent. Now, we actually met in Thunder Bay. You were there with Gary. Do you do a lot of conventions with other...
Stargate conventions? It's nice to do it with other Stargate actors. I do sometimes. Like, we're doing one in a big one in Chicago. Creation event with, like, Joe and Michael Shanks and Amanda Tapping and Tori... We'll be there, I think, Rachel. We'll be doing one in Melbourne, Australia, and Sydney, Australia, in August with Joe and myself and David Nicol and David Hewlett, and I think Tori as well. So, yeah, that's kind of fun. It's always fun. It's kind of like a reunion every time you see them, so it's cool.
That's what I was actually just about to wonder, because it's you were together for 5 years.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was like a family.
Yeah, it really is. It's family, and they're all great people, you know, and it's fun to see them, especially when we get to travel and go do stuff like, you know, like this. It's fun.
Now, because Stargate Atlantis was a spinoff of Stargate SG-1,
yep.
If they ever have like a Stargate thing, do you ever feel like that distant cousin, you know?
Well, you know, I mean, Stargate Atlantis and Stargate SG-1 were very close in a lot of ways. They had a very similar tone, I thought, and they were great to us, and we crossed over at the same time, where Stargate Universe started after we were finished. So we didn't really get to know any of those. I know some of them, but it was just kind of a different tone to the show a little bit. And it felt like that was a distant cousin, where the other two were like brother and sister a little bit more, I would say. But, it's a kind of a cool thing, you know?
You're right. Actually, yes. SG-1 and Stargate, because they, you know, did the Stargate back and forth. So they were connected.
Yeah. We're on the same lot. At the same time, you see those guys almost every day. We're in golf carts, and Joe is always on a skateboard, and we're driving little golf carts around or riding bikes or whatever, and they're in the same lot. Where the other show wasn't, we weren't there when that show was happening. So,
and it was also segregated because it's on a ship in a different galaxy.
Yeah, and it's a little darker, I thought, the tone, you know, different. But here's a little interesting trivia. I don't know but did you know that I was in SG-1 as well? I played the first person ever to go through the Stargate. A character named Ernest Littlefield. Yeah, and he wears a deep sea diving suit, and then he goes to the planet and he's aged. It's called Torment of Tantalus is the episode, and that's a little Stargate trivia. So when you're living in Vancouver and you're on Stargate at the time, all these friends of mine would be on Stargate like as different characters. They'd come back and they're like Jaffa or something, and then they'd be somebody else and somebody else. And I played that character, and I was like, damn, why can't I come back on the show and play a different role? Because, you know, it was fun to do. And then when I got Atlantis, I said to Martin Wood, I go, can I ask you a question? How come I never went back on the show as a different character? He goes, have you been to a convention yet? I said, no. And he goes, oh, okay, yeah. He goes, because you played Ernest, you played the first guy ever to go through the Stargate. We wouldn't have you on as a different character. Like, we have to do a different part of a different series on the same show. I go, why? And he goes, I went and did a convention. I'm like, oh, okay, I get it. Because to this day, fans can tell me way more about the episodes than I know. You know what I mean? They really know the episodes, and it's kind of a cool thing, you know? Which I never knew about. I didn't know the whole Stargate world was out there.
We actually had something like that with a guest a little while ago, Sean Rogerson.
Yeah.
He was on Grave Encounters, all this other stuff, but people remember him for one episode of Supernatural.
Oh, really?
Where he played a forest ranger that gets high off these turducken sandwiches. That's all, like, that's their go-to. So it's the same thing, you know? Now, having a reoccurring role, but it's like not the same character in a series, would that be difficult?
Well, they wouldn't do it, I don't think. I mean, unless the character is supposed to be like that. But I've been on shows where I played different characters. Like, I've been on Supernatural twice as different characters. And sometimes you have to wait a couple of seasons, and then they'll let you bring you back. I was on The X-Files as different characters twice. I think I did Cold Squad. I did, like, three different characters on Cold Squad, all different characters. So, you know.
So you've done it.
It depends. But so, like, a reoccurring character is the same character that you bring back all the time. That's kind of a reoccurring character. Yeah.
Okay. Any last call for questions? Now's your chance. There we go.
Yes, sir. Yeah, I mean, there's always talk of Stargate coming back in some capacity. I don't know for sure. I've heard a lot of rumors out there and stuff. And, yeah, of course I'd be interested, you know. Is that a Vancouver Grizzlies hat right there, I see? That's a cool hat. so we'll see what happens. At some point in time, maybe that will come to play. Of course I'd be interested. It's a really fun place, you know, the fun show to be on. I mean, I think they created an amazing world. The gate's the star of the show. Every episode, you go through the gate, and you're in it. It's such a really cool concept, you know. Sort of like, reminds me a little bit of like Quantum Leap, you know. It had that sensibility, too. And the humor in Stargate was a ton of fun. And it, for me, my character gets to do a lot of comedy and drama because he's like Scottish and wears his heart on his sleeve. It's a fun character to play. So it was a pleasure. And hopefully it will come back. I think there's a fan base for it. Certainly.
Well, two pieces of information then, because tonight we are having an after party. And Paul will be there to ask 10 questions on Stargate Atlantis. We've made sure to handpick certain questions so that Dr. Carson Beckett is somewhat of a focus.
So you're going to ask me questions?
No. You get to ask the crowd questions. But it's going to be interesting to see if you actually know the answers.
Probably not. I'm guessing right now, how many questions is there?
10.
I bet you I maybe know 2.
Sorry, 11. There's a bonus question.
Okay, I maybe know 2.
And the second thing is, you guys are going to get to experience Carson Beckett one more time. 3:30 today, Paul McGillion will be here as Dr. Carson Beckett doing a charity auction.
Yes, I will throw some Scottish in there. I won't be Beckett. I'm not going to wear the costume, but I'm doing a charity auction for Big Brothers and Big Sisters. I brought some scripts. I bought a script from Stargate that I have. I bought some sides that you use on the day when you're shooting, my personal sides from a few episodes. And some of the episodes, Richard Dean Anderson is in as well, and Jason Momoa, of course, and all the regular cast. Connor Trinneer from Star Trek's in one of them. And then I brought some sides from Supernatural, and A Dog's Breakfast is a movie I did with David. And I brought a really kind of cool behind-the-scenes shot of myself, Jill Flanagan, and Jason Momoa that I'll auction off as well. Which is, and I'll sign all those things for you guys. And it's for Big Brothers and Big Sisters. So come on out and support the wee babies. You know what I mean?
Well, we've actually got a couple of things to add to that as well.
And yes.
One of our vendors is called Custom Coaster Plus. He's made a set of 4 ceramic coasters with Paul's picture, 4 different ones. And we'll hear an auction and sign them. And also, we've had donated to us from friends of mine, Rianne and Luke. They have the first 4 seasons of Stargate Atlantis on DVD that we'll be auctioning off as well.
And, of course, I'll sign those for you. And then you could put, like, hot scalding tea on top of me all the time.
Yep, there's Paul.
Or a cold beer sometimes. Or for Beckett, maybe a wee scotch. And Scotland, they say a wee dram.
Yes. So, everybody, Paul, thank you so much for coming to Chatham and
guys.
Being part of CKX.
Thank you guys for having me. Have a great afternoon. Have fun. Come by and say hi. I'll be over there and come to the charity auction and the sketch duel. Thanks, guys. Have a great one.
And we're back. Thank you for coming again. And it's time for our interview Q&A with Marianthi Evans. I pronounced it right? Okay.
You seem more worried about my last name than my first name.
No, I was waiting for you to just correct me on the Marianthi.
No, you did a great job.
Okay. Well... And how are you liking Chatham?
You know what? I've been to Chatham before because, believe it or not, I went to the University of Windsor.
I did read that.
Yeah, for theater. And my first roommate was from Chatham, so
Okay.
This is not my first visit to Chatham. Yeah.
Okay. Silly question, because I did my research last night.
Did you? No.
I'm nervous. Sorry.
Don't be nervous.
Well, this is only the fourth interview I've ever done.
Oh, really?
Yeah, well, I did two last year.
Okay.
And one a couple hours ago.
All right. And how are you liking it?
Oh, I love it.
Okay, good.
It's just been all week. It's just like, oh my God. Yeah. I have to do questions and all that stuff.
Sure.
Anyway, looking at the body of work that you have.
Right.
How much of a regular are you to the Comic-Con?
Not at all.
No?
Believe it or not. This is my second.
Ever?
Yeah.
Same here.
Yeah, I'm very new to this world. And I guess because I just see myself as a once in a while working actress. So I don't see myself as somebody like with that people would want to come and see. So when I'm invited, I'm like, really? I'm new in this whole thing. Yeah, for sure.
Okay. Well, the only reason I asked was it occurred to me when I was looking over the stuff you had done.
Right.
One was the major one that jumped out at me, which was Max Payne. And with a movie like that, which is based on a video game, you would... Well, most of the cast, I imagine, would make the rounds of the comic conventions, I would suppose. Video games, movies, books usually are a big staple, as most can see, at most of the conventions. But
I've never been asked.
No?
No.
No, I'm just the dead
I've
wife.
I've never been asked. Literally, it's like, even when Rob asked me to be a part of this one, I said, listen, Rob, I said, yeah, I've done Max Payne and Defiance, and I just did Assassin's Creed Odyssey, so I have the... So I do have the sci-fi and comic book stuff under my belt, but I'm like, do you really think it should be... He's like, absolutely.
Am I going to fit in?
Like, well, not fit in, but like the one thing, you know, it's like, where people don't even want to talk to me, and he's like, oh yeah, for real, and it's been... a wonderful welcome. Like, I've had so many people come up and approach me and like been so lovely and so friendly, and I think this is something I'm definitely gonna invest in more. Yeah.
Yeah, well, I'm just as unfamiliar with it as you are, this being only my second time as well.
Oh, really?
One of the things that I did read up was that and forgive me, most of my background research would be from IMDb.
That's
so if it's wrong,
I'll correct you.
Please do. That when you're not acting, and this was, I guess, a few years ago, managing a...
No, that's out of date.
That's out of date?
That is out of date. No, it's wrong. No, that's wrong.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
I used to manage my dad. My father just recently passed away, actually, a couple months ago. He had a billiard hall bar, and I used to manage that years ago.
Okay. Okay.
And that was maybe, it's super out of date. It's like, I think it was 10 years ago.
All right.
Or 11, 9 or 10 years ago. So no, I don't manage that anymore.
Okay.
No. So
I had to find something. Like, I need to ask her about something.
Yeah.
Except aside from Max Payne.
Right. No, that's totally fine. But you can ask me anything. Doesn't mean I'll answer it.
Oh, fair enough. Was there one thing, it could be many things, but was there one thing that sort of sparked your interest? Like, I want to do this, like in acting? Yeah, to get into acting.
You know what? It was something that I always wanted to do as a little girl. I knew ever since I was a little girl I wanted to be an actress, but I didn't know how to do it.
Okay.
And I'm first generation Greek Canadian, so my parents, you know, are immigrants to this country. And back then, you didn't have internet. You know, you didn't have it.
You didn't
have cell phones. I think my dad had a car phone. Like, I don't know, do you even know what a car phone is? We had a rotary phone, you know?
Oh,
so we didn't even know how to get me involved. So I think I was in my mid-teens that I decided, what's the point? Stop dreaming. It's not going to happen. Do something more realistic. And I actually did, I thought I wanted to be a broadcast journalist.
Okay.
And I did a year of journalism at Carleton, university in Ottawa, and a month into the program, I knew I made a mistake. This wasn't for me, but I finished the year anyway, and then I took a year off of school, and I was talking to a friend of mine who's an actor, and I said, this is something I've always wanted to do, and he looked at me and he said, get training. He said, I don't care how naturally talented you are, just like athletes need to train, actors right. need to train as well. You need to develop some type of technique. My first audition ever was to audition for the theater program at the University of Windsor. I got in, and and I graduated in 2004 and have been working ever since. So I've been a little fortunate.
Well, congratulations.
I think out of my graduating class, there was about 30 of us. I think five of us continue pursuing it, but one or two of us are actually working.
Oh, yeah.
It's a tough business. It's a tough industry. It's definitely not for the thin-skinned, yeah.
And I can totally understand that because I have a friend... A former coworker, who's a friend of mine, who went to, I believe he's still going to University of Windsor, and he, if he hasn't graduated, he's about to. I think he has though, but he performs in plays in Windsor on a regular basis. Like they did one that was like a spoof on Riverdale. He did Evil Dead the musical. All that
oh,
stuff.
My friend wrote that Evil Dead the musical.
Oh yeah,
well, one of my friends is a producer and writer of that.
Well,
his name is just like totally escaped my head right now.
Yeah, that happened to me. That happened to me a couple
Charles,
hours
that's
ago.
It.
Well, my friend Dalton was the lead.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, he played Ash in that one.
Oh wow. Okay. Yeah. Yeah.
So,
I mean, you have to do it because you love it. If you're doing it to become rich and famous, don't, because that's only a small percentage.
Oh yeah,
and of people,
and he's crazy in love with it because it moved to
yeah,
Toronto,
you have to.
Moved back. And then,
oh, you have to love it. Yeah. But that's another question you have to ask yourself, too. Is success how much money you make, or is success you're doing something that you love and you get to keep doing it? You know, so am I, like, you know, would somebody classify me as successful or not successful because I'm not a millionaire? If that's how you're going to judge it, then, well, I guess I'm not.
Absolutely. And I saw an interview with, I don't know if it was Colin Farrell. It was another, Colin Farrell or another actor. And they made basically a super awesome point about acting school, yeah. And it's like he was working. He decided to go to, I think it was 3 years of drama school. Graduated from that, and then he started booking gigs and acting in movies and stuff. And he's like, well, is the drama school really that important? And he's like, well, it's not super exciting, but it is the 3 years he spent at drama school is 3 years that he didn't spend getting turned down on audition after audition after audition. He had all this training to base his life on.
You know what, and it's funny because I think a lot of people, it's not a very stable career. And there is most of it is rejection. And I think a lot of people that I went to school with didn't pursue it because of the fear of not working.
You're going to have to go on hundreds of auditions.
And oh yeah, and I, the best way I can describe this work is it's called Hurry Up and Wait. For example, I got an email. What is today? Saturday, right? I got an email on Thursday at 5 p.m. saying I had an audition the next day for a TV show at 1:20 p.m. Like it's that last minute. Like it's that, you know. What was I gonna say? But no, I mean, years ago, I was driving through Windsor. And my old teacher said, can you talk to my second years? I said, sure. And the one thing I said to them, I said, you're being taught, I really agree with taking acting lessons or some type of training, because even if you have natural talent, you need to know how to hone it, or you need to know how to just use it or work with it. And there are so many different techniques and methods. And I said to the students, because I'm like, I know you guys are all hating this and you think it's stupid and unnecessary and you're learning this method and that method. I go, you're not going to use all of it when you leave. Do it now because you have to, because you're in academic school. Like, because you just decided to go to university for this. So you have to do right. The paperwork. You have to do what you think is nonsense. But when you leave here, you're going to take what works for you. I said, probably almost everything that I, every different technique or method that we were taught in school, I said, I found what works best for me, and that's what works best for me. I said, right. I don't use this one, I don't use this one, I don't use this one. But just, you do need some type of training.
Yeah, and who knows if you were auditioning for a job and you didn't have the training, you didn't know certain terminology, and they ask you to do something, and you know what it is they're going to ask you to do, but you don't know the exact word for it. And they're like, oh, well, I don't want to deal with this person. They know nothing.
Yeah. But also, too, the more you do something, the better you get at it. Right? The more you do something, the better you get at it.
Oh, absolutely.
Right? It's so
practice.
So you just
practice,
like,
you'll practice. Just,
I mean, there have been some scenes that I've done, and they've been very emotional scenes, and they're like, where'd you get that from? Like, I don't know, I pulled it out of somewhere. But it's, you know.
There was a soap opera I watched last week.
You learn more with experience, of course, but I'm a firm believer in some type of training. 100%.
Right.
Cuz you you're going in with nothing behind your belt. So it's the same thing. Like, you go to school to become a lawyer, you know. I don't know. It's maybe not the same example. It's a bad example, but...
Well, no. I mean, like, unless you're an absolute savant, you can just pick up anything. You need the theory.
Yeah.
Yes.
You need to develop some type of something. You can't just go in without some type of... something.
yeah, you need a base of some sort. Basic understanding of the industry you've chosen. Yeah. You brought up Assassin's Creed right off the bat. How did you manage to get into the voice acting?
They were by fluke, actually. This was my second time that Ubisoft called me for an audition, but they were specifically looking for a Greek accent.
Oh, yeah.
Because it takes place in ancient Greece.
Right.
So thank God, you know, the years of making fun of my parents. So that's pretty much it. So the way it works is an agent will get a casting call, and it will still, you'll give little specifics of what they're looking for, and then they'll think in the roster, well, who do I have that can do that? Oh, I have Marianthi. So then they'll submit my headshot and resume, and then the casting director will decide if they want to bring me in or not. So for that one, they were specifically, hi, Rob.
There he is.
They were specifically looking for a Greek accent. Then it's literally, I would say 90% of this business, if not 99% of this business, is luck. It really is luck. It's the luck of the draw of, like, who's seeing you. Like, Max Payne, when I was casting Max Payne, I was on hold, meaning when an actor's on hold, it means they're deciding between you and somebody else. I was on hold for 6 weeks because the director wanted me, but the producer wanted somebody else.
Oh.
But so I was just lucky enough that I was called in for that, and then the director...
Caught someone's eye.
Yeah, caught someone's eye. So again, I was just lucky that they were looking for a specific accent, which, like I said, making fun of my parents for years, I was able to pull off. And that's pretty much how I got it.
Right place, right time.
But actually. And an agent, well, and also what's important is having an agent that believes in you and that knows what you're capable of and will submit you for things and fight for you. That's also important, too. Yeah.
Well, yeah, get your name out there.
Yeah, exactly.
Get your headshot out there.
Yeah, but, I mean, I would love to do more voiceover work. Are you kidding? It's the best. Roll out of bed in your PJs, go into a booth. It's, like, fantastic. You don't have to dress up or wear makeup. It's great. Oh,
well,
it's the best.
And Becky was talking all about it earlier. Five Nights at Freddy's.
Yeah.
Children's show.
Yeah.
Getting all animated.
It's a small industry, and every branch of it, like the voice world, is its own small world, and then the TV world is its own small world, and the commercial world is its own small world, and a good friend of mine is a voice actor, and he also directs, and I keep on joking with him, like, come on, dude, just give me an audition. I'm like, but he's like, I would if I could. It's hard, but. I would love to branch more into voice work, 100%.
I've seen some actors, you'll see an actor in a movie, and it's like, oh, what else has this person done?
Right.
And you'll look, and they've got 200 and something credits to their name, but they've been in two movies. But they've been in who knows how many cartoons, video games.
Yeah.
Just like all the voice acting, because one job leads to another job leads to another job.
It's true.
And if it's a TV show, that's multiple seasons.
It's so true. Oh, my God, I'd kill for my own series right now. Are you kidding? Well, maybe not kill, but...
Because I had looked into the series that you had done. You did... it was an episode of Flashpoint. And I was about to ask you, like, oh, did you get to interact with, like, Hugh Dillon?
I did, yeah.
Oh, you did?
I did. Yeah. I did act with Hugh.
Massive fan of the Headstones.
Are you?
Oh, yes. And then you've got Veronica Mars' dad on the show, too, the Enrico.
Yeah. I worked with, I worked with Hugh. I worked with, I'm still bad with names. I worked with Hugh and the, I'm so bad, I'm so sorry.
I always help out people I work with this. You give me just something,
I can
answer your question.
I'm the worst with names. I'm horrible. That's why I got out of journalism. Who did you interview? Oh, that guy. I don't remember.
You know, the mustache dude.
Yeah, the mustache with the glasses. He's the president of that country. Right. Like, it's, oh, are you kidding? It'd be embarrassment.
Yeah. It's a show I've been circling for years that I wanted to get into, because fan of a lot of the people on the show, and it's a Canadian. It was a Canadian-made show.
Point, yeah.
Yeah.
And it didn't hide that it was in Canada.
Yeah,
it didn't hide
Toronto,
it. It's Toronto, yeah. It didn't hide it. Because so many shows that are filmed here, they won't. Canada's getting better in producing a lot of their own shows.
And one of the only ones
in,
I ever saw about that made you aware that they were in Toronto was Traders.
Right. Yeah.
Because they always mentioned Bay Street and stuff. I'm like, I took that subway.
Yeah. But no, Flashpoint, I think, was one of the first ones that didn't hide that it was in Toronto.
Yeah.
Like, you saw Scarborough, you saw that, you saw, like, or the street names, or TTC. Yeah, it was,
What was the other one? Defiance.
Yeah.
Now, was it a guest spot on that? Because it said just a few episodes.
So it was a recurring role. So how I got that, it's funny, because my character, Gail, she was Graham Greene's right-hand man.
Okay.
So that was called a recurring role. So when I first auditioned for that role, she didn't even have a name. I think it was just like a one episode thing. And it was a director's session. Michael Nankin was the director and one of the producers. And then he had me read for another part. I was to play one of the aliens who was the mayor's right hand.
Okay.
So I got cast as that, and I was super excited. So I was like, yes, I get to be an alien. I get to wear makeup, and this is fantastic. And then they said, no, we lied. We can't give you that part, because I was physically, it was the aliens, like the very pale skin, the statuesque, like very skinny model type.
Right.
But they're like, well, you physically don't meet the requirements of this, but they're gonna give you the female minor. My part was called female minor,
okay.
And I was like, really? I was like, what should I do? Anyway, I took the part. Turns out that part, the one that I was originally cast as,
right?
Like, you saw her maybe once,
and
by. Then mine ended up being a recurring character with a name. Her name is Gail, and then
how that worked out.
I know, so it actually worked out in my favor. So that was fun.
Okay, well, I've been hogging you most this time.
That's okay.
And for the few people that we have here, did anyone have any questions here for Marianthi? I will walk over.
I don't think so, no.
No? Okay. Well, then I will move on to... do you notice any differences between the movies you've done, working in movies, and the TV shows?
I mean...
differences between on a film set or a TV set?
It all depends on the budget.
Right.
You'll know. The biggest differences I've noticed is who's with the budget. Like, Max Payne was a Fox Studio production.
Big
so
movie.
They had a budget. Also, too, TV shows, it's more of a crunch time, I think. For example, I did an episode of Ransom. We shot that in Hungary. And then about 2 months after we shot that episode aired. So there's less time, I think.
Right.
For TV shows based on movies, but then again, it all goes down to the money. It really does. I just finished a film, and it was a low budget independent Canadian film, and it was like hi. But honestly, the biggest difference you'll see is the budget. Who's got the money to spend determines I don't want to say how you're pampered, maybe, or just how you're taken care of.
Whether you have
like
a trailer or...
Well, basically, because like the indie film that I did, we shot at the director's cottage, and my bedroom was being used as a hallway. So like at one point, because it was adjoined with another room that they used as like storage. So every time they need, so it's here I am like 4 or 5 in the morning sleeping, and like people are like cutting through my room.
Oh my goodness.
To get stuff, whereas in Max Payne I had my own trailer, I had my privacy, or just like
right.
I sound like a spoiled brat right now, but
it is something that I've heard before, where it's just you're staying at your parents' house or.
Yeah, you know, it's but that's the big, but TV shows I think have a different timeline based on when something needs to get done as opposed to a movie, because yeah. Like, you know, episode 10 is airing this day, so this has to be ready that day, so yeah.
Well, that was almost like there was a movie that I read that you did, Witch Hunter Gretel.
What happened?
There was one called Witch Hunter Gretel.
Oh yeah.
And there was a coincidence because Paul McGillion was in that as well.
Yeah, he was. I actually, when he sat next to me, I'm looking at him. I'm like, I think that's what's his face. And then I said to him, I said, were you in Witch Slayer? He goes, like, the Shannon Doherty. I'm like, yeah. I was the one. He's like, all right, I remember you. Small world. Yeah, I know.
And I wasn't gonna go too in depth with it because I hadn't heard of it before. But I'm like,
you don't need to. It's
oh wait,
okay.
He's here too.
Yeah.
So that was the extent of that.
Yeah, but. No, but it's funny. It is a small world. Like the acting world is a small world.
Yeah.
Even like in where my career and where the level of our careers right now, it's like it's a small world. Oh, I'll tell you how small the world is. A friend of mine named Tari, okay. He's a screenwriter. He worked on Suits. He just recently wrote the Man of Steel 2 movie.
Oh, yeah, the one that everyone's waiting for.
I don't know. I asked him what's going on with it. He's like, ugh. Anyway, he's back in Toronto. He tried to voice chat me, and I couldn't answer because I was driving.
Okay, well, yeah.
And I'm like, what do you want? I'm driving. I can't answer. He's like, I'm with your husband. I'm like, I've never been married. What are you talking about? He's like, no. He's like, I'm with Mark Wahlberg right now. We're having a meeting. And I was like, ah, that's funny. I'm like, damn it, is that what you're trying to voice chat me? I was like, jerk, I'm driving. Anyway, like, again, small world. Even with the A-listers, it can be a small world. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, that also helps you get more jobs if they enjoyed working with you.
Oh yeah.
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 Did you interact with Mark much?
I did. All my scenes were with him. Very lovely. Very, very sweet guy. I was not expecting it. I became a fan of his after doing this movie, because every time I thought of Mark Wahlberg, I thought of Marky Mark and the Funky Bunch.
Well, I imagine most people are guilty.
Yeah,
of that.
I mean, I was born in the 70s, right? So like I.
Oh yeah, it was same here.
Yeah.
So I remember his music. Back
I remember
then.
The Funky Bunch. So I was like, oh, dude, it's Marky Mark. I can't. But then when I met him, I was like, oh, this guy's actually really cool and he's really nice. He's really sweet. He's a sweetheart.
I have heard that about him.
He's wonderful. Yeah.
I had also heard that he's pretty proud of Max Payne as well. No, don't believe everything
we
you
are.
Read, I suppose.
No, I'm kidding.
No?
No? No, it was fun. It was good. I mean, it was a great experience at a great time. It gave me an experience that many... I mean, I got to go to the red carpet. I got to go to Hollywood. I got to go to the premiere. It gave me an experience that many people will not be able to...
Very much a once-in-a-lifetime experience.
100%. Hopefully it won't be the last. There'll be another one, but...
Well, here's to hoping.
Yeah.
Okay, well, I think they're starting to amass a bit, and we've got a few minutes till the cosplay competition comes on.
Sweet.
So it was awesome speaking with you.
Thank you.
Thank you for coming back to Chatham.
Coming back. You're very welcome.
And I hope you enjoy the rest of the con.
I will. Thank you so much.
All right.
Thank you. Bye.
Enjoy yourselves, guys.
So, I'm going to start off. My name is Anna, and I'm from Arendelle, and I am so happy to be here with you guys. I'm going to start off with one of my favorite songs. Feel free to join in. Do you want to build a snowman? Come on, let's go and play. I never see you anymore. Come out the door, it's like you've gone away. Used to be best buddies, and now we're not. I wish you would tell me why. Do you want to build a snowman? It doesn't have to be a snowman. Okay, bye. Mm-hmm. filled a snowman. I ride our bikes around the halls. I think some company is overdue. I started talking to the pictures on the walls. It gets a little lonely, all these empty rooms, just watching the hours tick by. Elsa, please, I know you're in there. People are asking where you've been. They say have courage, and I'm trying to. I'm right up here for you. Just let me in. We only have each other. It's just you and me. What am I gonna do? Do you wanna build a snowman? It's a lot warmer in here than it is in Arendelle. Why, thank you. And now for my next song, I'm going to change it up a little bit. One of my best friends, her name is Ariel, and I'm going to sing you one of my favorite songs by her. Look at this stuff, isn't it neat? Wouldn't you think my collection's complete? Wouldn't you think I'm the girl who has everything. Look at this trove, treasures untold. How many wonders can one color hold? Looking around here, you'd think, sure, she's got everything. I've got gadgets and gizmos aplenty. I've got who's-its and what's-its galore. You want thingamabobs? I've got 20. But who cares? No big deal, I want more. I want to be where the people are. I want to see them dancing, smoking around on those, what do you call them? Oh, feet? Flipping your fins, you don't get too far. Legs? I'm required for jumping, dancing, strolling along down a, what's that word again? Street. Up where they walk, up where they run, up where they stay all day in the sun. Wandering free, wish I could be part of that world. What would I give if I could live out of these waters? What would I pay to spend a day warm on the sand? Bet you on land, they understand that they don't reprimand their daughters. Bright young women, sick of swimming, ready to stand. And ready to know what the people know. Ask them my questions and get some answers. What's a fire and why does it? What's the word? Burn. When's it my turn? Wouldn't I love to explore the shore up above? Out of the sea. Wish I could be part of your world. Thank you. Thank you so much. A little loud. The window was open, so's that door. I didn't know they did that anymore. Who knew we owned 8,000 silent plates? For years I've roamed these empty halls. Why have a ballroom with no balls? Finally they're opening up the gate. It'll be totally strange. Wow, am I so ready for this change? 'Cause for the first time in forever, there'll be music, there'll be light. For the first time in forever, I'll be dancing through the night. Don't know if I'm elated or gassy, but I'm somewhere in that zone. 'Cause for the first time in forever, I won't be alone. Oh, I can't wait to meet everyone. What if I meet the one? Tonight, imagine me gown and ball, fetchingly draped against the wall, a picture of sophisticated grace. I suddenly see him standing there, a beautiful stranger, tall and fair. I want to stuff some chocolate in my face. But then we laugh and talk all evening, which is totally bizarre. Nothing like the life I've led so far. For the first time in forever, there'll be magic, there'll be fun. For the first time in forever, I could be noticed by someone. And I know it all ends tomorrow, so it has to be today. 'Cause for the first time in forever, at least I've got a chance. Thank you. So I've been requested to do a song here. The snow blows white on the mountain tonight, not a footprint to be seen. Kingdom of isolation, and it looks like I'm the queen. The wind is howling like this swirling storm inside. Couldn't keep it in, heaven knows I tried. Don't let them in, don't let them see. Be the good girl you always have to be. Conceal, don't feel, don't let them know. Well, now they know. Let it go, let it go. Can't hold it back anymore. Let it go, let it go. Turn away and slam the door. Storm rage on. The cold never bothered me anyway. It's funny how some distance makes everything seem small. The fears that once controlled me can't get to me at all. It's time to see what I can do to test the limits and break through. No right, no wrong, no rules for me. I'm free. Let it go, let it go. Can't hold it back anymore. Let it go, let it go. Turn away and slam the door. I don't. My soul is spiraling in frozen fractals all around, and one thought crystallizes like an icy blast. I'm never going back. The past is in the bothered me anyway. Just so everyone knows, I'm going to be over, I don't know how to describe where I'm going to be at, over to the left of me, at Tony Gray's booth, right beside there, and I will be signing and selling pictures, and would love to see you all there, and yeah, thank you.
You are going to get to meet a very good friend of mine.
Oh, okay.
I am a member of the Movie Madhouse podcast.
Okay.
There are three of us. James was up here earlier.
Right.
This is Jason.
Hello, Jason. Hello. It's a pleasure to meet you. Hi.
There you go, buddy.
All right. Eddie Deezen.
Yes, sir.
This is an honor, sir.
Thank you.
This is an honor. Now, I'm just going to start with my own personal story.
Okay.
Because I know this. Eugene in Greece...
Right.
Is the first, what would be become known as the first movie nerd.
Is that right?
You were the first. You originated that character.
That's an interesting... Okay, I wrote an article about that. I write stuff. I wonder, if was Harold Lloyd the first in silent films? Was Harold Lloyd, would you consider that a nerd?
I want to say no. Not in the... what we would classify as a
okay.
nerd.
And then the only other one I think of is Charles Martin Smith in American Graffiti. He was kind of a nerdy guy.
Yeah.
Not a mean. Now, I started the one where the nerd has the highest voice, you know, with the pencil protectors. Charles,
yes.
He was kind of different, but he was a nerd. But when I started doing it, everybody started coming out like that. They go,
yes.
Hi, how are you? Da 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 da. And they would all play the nerd like that.
You get the cred, man.
Thank you.
You are the originator. You are the first. We bow to you,
well,
sir.
Well, thank you so much. I appreciate it. I appreciate your servility. Thank you.
I'm going to start with the easiest, the most common question.
Okay.
What was the experience like with Greece?
I get that all the time. Greece was like, imagine the greatest party of your life. You go to the greatest party of your life, and it lasted 2 months. That's what Greece was like. Everybody was so nice. Everybody was so wonderful. Travolta was so nice. Olivia Newton-John was so nice. Jeff Conaway was a little bit gnarly. He was a little bit off, but everybody else was wonderful.
He came across like that later in life.
Yeah.
He really... Seemed odd there.
Yeah, now he did mellow out later. He got to be a real nicer guy later. We got to be very close. We would do signing shows together side to side. He was like an older brother to me.
Nice.
He was a great guy. But in those days, he was a little bit scary. Yeah.
That's nice to hear.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
I've heard stories. I remember seeing him on, I want to say Celebrity Rehab or something
yeah.
like that.
Yeah, those were sad days.
A little, yeah.
You know what happened? When they did Grease Lightning, it was supposed to be Jeff's number, but they gave it to John. Randall Kleiser, the director, turned it over to John, and he took over the number. Anyway, you'll see Grease Lightning, and you'll see Jeff do a flip. They're doing Grease Lightning, you know, and Jeff does a flip on the car, and you see him hit it, and that's what started it.
Okay.
And he had 9 back operations. He had to take painkillers. But that's what brought Jeff to his downfall. That's what started it.
Wow.
It was a sad thing. And that's my favorite number in the movie, but it just happened that way.
Correct me if I'm wrong.
Yeah.
You weren't a part of the hand jive scene, though, were you?
Hand jive. Born to hand jive. I remember rehearsing it. We did like... I remember rehearsing it, so I was probably there. I was in the dance scene pretty much through it.
You were there in the scene, yes, but I don't remember like seeing Eugene dancing.
Maybe not. They kind of took the camera off me. When I did Grease, I was like right off the streets. I was a total unprofessional, and the director would say, "Do something," and I wouldn't do it. I just kept. He goes, "Eddie, don't dance." I go, "Da da, hands up, da da." I doing my stuff, and he goes, "Eddie, don't do that." And I go, "Okay." And then they go, "Action," and I go, "I'm still doing this stuff." You know, I didn't know. You know, you listen to your director, but I was just an idiot off the street. So he had the camera. You'll see a lot of scenes there. They're just cutting me off. You watch Grease carefully. You'll see kind of like a little bit off me to the side. You see me a little bit, but I'm kind of cut off to the side in a lot of scenes.
I think we need to start a campaign.
Yeah.
For them to put out a new version.
Right.
The Deezen cut.
Yeah, you're right. Okay. I would like that.
More Eddie. More
yes.
Eugene.
I'm for that.
Okay. We're going to start the campaign here, folks. All right. So then, you know, things go on. War Games.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yeah, Mr. Potato Head. Yeah.
Mr. Potato Head?
Yes.
Really?
That's what they call me in the movie.
Really?
Yeah, he says, Mr. Potato, he made that up. It wasn't in the script. And then my friend Maury Chaykin is there. He goes, I'm going to call you Mr. Potato Head. And I go, oh, that's funny. And that was just made up by him. Maury was a great partner. Yeah.
Maury Chaykin was a legend.
He was a great guy. He was a great comedy partner.
That's nice to hear. I've never heard much about him, that's nice to hear.
Yeah.
But now War Games, that's an entirely different type of film. Compared to Grease, right?
They changed. President Reagan saw War Games, and he literally changed the security system of America because of that movie. He saw how easy it is to tap into the computers, and he changed the system because of that movie. Believe it or not.
True. Wow. Well, it doesn't surprise me. Yeah. This was a president who came from Hollywood.
Yeah.
So for him to take inspiration from it, really not surprising at all.
And that movie, too, I was the first computer nerd. That you said I was the first nerd. That was the first computer nerd. That was definitely the first computer nerd.
That's the subculture of nerds,
exactly,
if you will.
Exactly, exactly, yeah.
Now, was it War Games that you were connected to, which is why you were never approached? Okay, in my journalistic integrity here, I'm not a real journalist.
Oh, that's okay.
According to
You're doing great.
According to Wikipedia, you were never approached for Revenge of the Nerds.
No, I talked to the producer, Adam Field. I did a mediocre movie called The Whoopi Boys with him, Adam Field. And I go, why didn't you put me in Revenge of the Nerds? I look like a nerd. He goes, that was the joke of the movie. He goes, we wanted to get regular-looking guys and dress them up as nerds. He goes, you already look that way. You actually look like this nerd. So that's what he told me.
I
get that question all the time. They go, why weren't you in Revenge of the Nerds? You're such a geek, you know. But that's.
I could have easily, I can easily picture you in the Poindexter role.
Yeah.
With the violin at the end and everything.
Yeah, I could easily have done that.
To me, that's where I would see you in that movie.
I've gotten mistaken for that guy, for Robert Carradine, so many times.
Really?
In my life. Yeah, they go, that's the guy from Revenge of the Nerds. I get that all the time.
Oh, jeez.
Yeah.
Come on. Yeah. Know your nerds, people. and then you led into voice acting. You have that such a distinct voice.
Yes.
It really sounds natural for you to be into voice acting.
Yeah.
So
I had a hard time remembering my lines. And when we did War Games, I kept screwing up my lines. I go, it's a new data encryption. It's a new data. I kept screwing up. So the director goes, come here. He goes, Eddie, you're costing us millions of dollars here. We're going to write your thing on idiot cards. We're going to write your thing out. So he wrote my dialogue on idiot cards, and I read it off. I go, it's a new data encryption algorithm. But if you watch War Games, you'll see I'm reading all that. Yeah. I couldn't remember that line.
I've got to revisit War Games. It's been a while, and I'll be looking for that.
Yeah.
So you got into voice acting because it's a little easier, but were you approached for that, or did you just,
I went to an agency. I was with a regular agency, and then I went to a voiceover agency, and I started getting cast, and I started doing those roles. When I started doing voiceovers in the 90s, it was like this insular community. It was like just a few of us, and I would get all the nerd roles, you know. Nowadays, everybody does voiceover. Everybody, you know, you just audition from your computer. You just audition and do a thing on your computer, and you punch it in, and it's an audition. So it's a different world now.
Yeah. But again, a distinct voice stands out.
Oh, thank you. Thank you very much.
Yourself. That's a very distinct sound. Can you name some of the projects you've done voice acting wise?
Polar Express.
A lot of people might not even realize.
Yeah, Polar Express. They think it was voiceover, but it was we did act out Polar Express. Polar Express, me and Tom Hanks, and we get up every day, and they glue these dots to our face. They put 152 dots. The makeup man put dots, a Sharpie, and he'd mark our face with 152 spots. Then a lady would come in and glue dots to our face, 152 dots. And there was some kind of a light thing that it was called motion capture. And they'd shine a light on us, and we would act out the scene, me, Tom, and we'd act out the, and then they'd go cut. And then they'd have these little kids. They had a little kid, Tom Hanks, me, Peter Scolari, Nona, these kids, and they would do the same scene. I go, I want all those presents, Santa Claus, give me those presents. And they go cut, and then the kids would do it. The little kid would go, I want all those presents. And somehow they morphed us together. That's how they did the movie. But the kids would do the same scene after us.
That's amazing.
That's
amazing. Yeah. But, you know, you hear that's how a lot of motion capture gets done anymore. Instead of just having the actors do the voices, they're getting the motion, the movements and whatnot, right?
Yeah, they did that with us.
Because it's modeled after
exactly.
you.
Exactly.
So
exactly.
You have your mannerisms. You have
right.
your gait for your walk and right. that kind of thing. So that's pretty cool. I had no idea they did that with Polar Express.
Yeah, the movements are it's us moving, but it's somehow us and kids together. I don't know exactly how they
Computers.
Did it. Yeah.
the blanket answer, computers.
Yeah, it's probably real different now because, you know, technology has come so far.
Yeah.
But that was the first motion capture film. That's how they did it in those days.
That's pretty awesome.
Yeah.
Now, what about TV shows? So you've done some
Magnum,
cartoons.
I did a Magnum PI with Tom Selleck. He was wonderful. We went to Hawaii, and he was the nicest guy. He made us dinner. He invited us up to his room, and he cooked us all dinner, and we watched the ball game together. He was a great guy.
Was the mustache really as epic as it looked on TV?
Yes, it was. Yeah. Yes. Great. He gave me black licorice, which I hate. Black licorice makes me sick, but it was Tom Selleck, you know. He goes, Eddie, you want some licorice? I go, yeah, okay, yeah, and I put it down. You know, it's horrible, but it's Tom Selleck, you know, so I ate the licorice.
You know? Now, you don't say no to a guy like Tom Selleck.
You don't say no to Tom Selleck, right.
Absolutely not. Exactly. I understand fully.
Yeah.
I mean, if I meet Kevin Smith is my idol. So if I ever meet Kevin Smith, I don't care what he's handing me. I'm putting it in my mouth.
Exactly. Exactly. Yeah.
No, I'm not joking.
Well, I'll tell Kevin about it. I'm sure he'll be happy to hear that.
Do you know Kevin?
No, I was making a joke.
Oh.
These are the jokes, folks. These are the jokes.
Okay. So now I lost where I was going with this.
Sure.
Are you doing anything now? Is there anything upcoming? Anything new that you're...
Not really. I'm signing over here. That's about it. And I've been auditioning. I just got back to town in January. I was very sick for 3 years. I was with my family in Maryland. And I just moved back to L.A. in January. So I did another show in Alabama in February, and I'm doing this one. I'm booked for a show in June, and then I'm booked for when Labor Day. So these are basically all I'm doing
right now.
Just
doing the contours?
Yeah. Hey. I mean, I've been auditioning for voiceovers, but I haven't got any yet. So we'll see what happens.
That's a shame.
Yeah, the business is crazy, you know. Hopefully it'll get better.
There's always going to be, should be a place for you.
I hope so. I'll be honest with you. It might be over. My career might be over. Maybe I'll just do these shows, you know. But I have money in the bank, so.
There you go.
It's been a great ride, you know. It's been a wonderful career, yeah.
Does anyone out there have any questions for Mr. Deezen?
Yes, sir. I know you. You're the great photographer guy. She's so wonderful, and I'll be honest, I only met her one time. I mean, I saw her on the set, but she was like in a different world. One day we hijacked the car on the Paramount lot. There was a red convertible on the Paramount lot, and there were four of us, and we just jumped in the car. And there was a driver, Olivia was there, I was there, and I was in the back seat behind her. And we just, you know, when you're young, you do crazy things. We drove it all around the lot, and then she looked at me, she goes, "You're funny." That's all she said, and that was the only time I talked to her. Anyway, I went to Las Vegas in 2014, and she waved to me. I go, she couldn't be waving to me. And then she goes, "This is my old pal from Greece," and she called me up on stage. And we got the hug, and I got to see her again. I go, "You're just as beautiful as when we did Greece," and I got to see her again. And she is just as lovely as when we did Greece. We went back to her dressing room. My mom met her, and my manager met her, and we all talked and reminisced. She is so lovely. She's such a doll. Yeah. But that I only met her the once in Greece. Yeah. Yeah.
Yes, sir. A lot of people, some people question this, but Grease 2.
Yes.
Different experience? Like,
yes.
A lot of different people.
Yeah.
But was it just in general a different
vibe? It wasn't
vibe?
As exciting. Grease was my first movie, so that it was very exciting in that. John Travolta was so huge at the time. John Travolta was like, you know, James Dean. He was like this huge star. So he made it exciting. I thought the songs were better in Grease. I thought everything was better about Grease. Grease 2, I remember meeting Michelle Pfeiffer. And she was so beautiful. And I just looked at her. I swear to God, I was like hypnotized. And I just walked up to her. I go, "You're beautiful." And she goes, "Thank you." That was the only time I talked to her. I saw her. And then Maxwell, the guy, that Maxwell Caulfield, who had the lead, he invited me into his dressing room, and we had tea and cookies together. He goes, Eddie, he's this British guy. Eddie, I'll make us some tea. And we had tea and cookies together. And I go, this is the nicest guy. But I knew he wasn't right for Greece. He was this genteel English guy. He's this British guy. And I knew it wasn't right.
Yeah, yeah. Grease 2 does hold a special place in my heart. I shared that movie with some cousins, and it was, really, it was a bonding experience.
Okay.
But definitely maybe not as well received and not as good as the original.
But it's funny because everybody has different tastes. I've met over the years maybe like 15 or 20 people who like Grease 2 better than Grease 1.
Really?
I go, are you serious? But they actually like it better. You know, everybody's got their own taste.
Exactly. Yeah. Yep. Yeah, and that's actually a discussion I had earlier today with someone. This product is not going to be for everyone. They aim it for, certain demographics and so on, right?
Yeah.
So whether Grease 2 ain't trying to go for the same thing, it really doesn't feel the same.
Yeah.
You know?
You're right. So. They're two different movies, pretty much. Yeah.
Very, very different.
Yeah.
Grease 2 does have its moments, though. So.
I guess so, yeah. Yeah.
But you weren't quite as prominent in that one as much as...
No, even less. Well, both of them I got cut out a lot. Grease, I got cut out
again,
a lot.
Again, we need the Deezen cut.
Eugene was not that important. Yeah.
Again,
yeah.
We need the Deezen cut. We got to make that happen.
Yeah. Anyway, when I got Eugene in Grease, when I got cast... This is a religious story. This is a true story. When I got cast as Eugene in Grease, they cast me, and I called all my... I go, I'm in this movie with John Travolta. I'm in this movie with... You know, I told everybody. I told all my friends. Anyway, the studio called a couple days later. They go, Eugene is a small role. We're going to cut it out of the movie. So, you know, I was devastated. I go, oh, my God, I was in this movie at John Travolta. Now I'm going to do it. Anyway, my agent called me, and she goes, we're going to go to church and pray. I go, what? I go, I'm Jewish. I don't go to church. She goes, we're going to go to church and pray together. This is a true story. So we go to this church on Vermont. She goes, we're going to light a candle at the altar. What? She goes, light a candle. We lit a candle at the altar, and I said a fervent prayer. I prayed, da-da-da. Anyway, about the next day or a day or two later, they said, Eugene, you're back in Greece. Paramount called, and they said, the role is back in Greece. So if you're a religious person, you believe that story. You go, that's an incredible religious story. If you're an atheist, you just go, it's a total coincidence. But it's a true story. That's how I got Eugene in Greece.
That's pretty awesome.
Yeah,
That's pretty awesome.
If you believe in prayer, it's prayer. Yeah.
Now, going back to my journalistic integrity,
yes.
I believe there was something on your Wikipedia about being abducted by aliens. Is there any truth to that?
No truth at all. I've been abducted by others, never aliens. No.
Okay. You've been abducted?
Yeah. Where'd you read? Oh, sure, yeah.
Actually, I made that up. That's what Wikipedia does, right?
Okay, yeah. Fake news, yeah.
Anybody else have any questions? Sure.
Yes, sir. That would be
Eddie
nice,
Deezen and Rick Moranis. I'm picturing, not quite a buddy cop situation, but maybe down on the luck private investigators.
Right. Maybe so. It's an idea. Yeah. Who knows? Maybe
going
someday.
To get Putin team. All right.
Yeah.
Well, unfortunately, I'm kind of out of questions here. Do you have any stories you want to share? Any?
I got a million stories. I don't know. I don't know what to say. What do you want to hear? I go, I don't know. Well, let's see. I got a Tom Hanks story.
Oh, please.
Okay. Anyway, do you remember Captain Kangaroo? Captain Kangaroo, we were filming Polar Express when Captain Kangaroo died. And I was in makeup. And I love Captain Kangaroo. When I was a kid, I watched Captain Kangaroo. But I'm in makeup one day and Captain Kangaroo died. Anyway, Tom Hanks comes in. And we talked about how we both loved Captain Kangaroo. We're talking, we were both so bummed out. And we were both sad because Captain Kangaroo died. Anyway, they got my makeup on, and I went outside the trailer, and I'm waiting there in the sun. Anyway, Tom Hanks comes out of the trailer, and I'm standing there. I was real glum, and Tom Hanks comes there, and he sings to me. He sings the Tom Terrific song. It was on Captain Kangaroo. He sang me the song. He goes, I'm Tom Terrific. My dog is little. He sang the whole song just from, I'm looking up. This is friggin' Tom Hanks. I'm looking up. He's singing me the song. I was totally overwhelmed. He sang it note for note the entire song. I looked at him. I didn't know what to say, so I just go, you know what? You're a great guy. And he just walked off. But that was what Tom Hanks was like. He was this magical guy. He's like Santa Claus, but he was this magical guy, and he sang me the Captain Kangaroo song. That's the way he is. Yeah. Oh, yeah? I remember Mr. Green Jean, sure. Yeah, I remember that. Yeah, I remember.
See, and that's why Tom Hanks is America's dad.
That's right. That's he's just like you would imagine him. He's just that cool of a guy.
And he should probably be promoted for sainthood, I think. Yeah.
He might be elected. You're right. I can tell you, when I threw up in Steven Spielberg's toilet, I can tell you that story. We were filming 1941.
Sounds like we just got the punchline, right? But
when we did 1941, I'm on a Ferris wheel the whole movie. I spend the whole movie on a Ferris wheel with my dummy. I have a ventriloquist dummy. Anyway, Steven was whipping us around. We're in the Ferris wheel. He's whipping us around real fast. And I got sick. I go, stop the Ferris. So Steven goes, go lay down in my dressing room. So I crawled on my, I went into Steven Spielberg's dressing room. I'm in his dressing room, I'm laying in the cot. And I got on my hands and knees. I crawled to the toilet. I went to the bathroom and I threw up. I threw up in the toilet because I was motion sick. I go, oh my God, I threw up in Steven Spielberg's toilet. I go, I just threw up in Steven Spielberg's toilet. It was an honor. That was one of the highlights of my career. Yeah.
You need a t-shirt of that now.
Right,
you need,
right.
I threw
you're
up
right.
in Steven Spielberg's toilet.
That's right.
Because how many
true
people
story.
Have that story?
You're right.
You know,
you're right.
That's probably a one of a kind.
I use the story to pick up chicks. I pick up chicks. I tell them that story. They flock to me.
Hey, whatever floats your boat.
That's right, yes.
No judgments here.
That's right.
I totally forgot about 1941.
Yeah. John Belushi, wonderful guy. Dan Aykroyd. John Belushi, I can't believe he's been gone for 37 years. He's such a wonderful guy.
Yeah?
Yeah, he was just the delightful, nicest guy ever.
So he wasn't the heavy party animal?
No, not that I saw. I'm on the set one day, and Steven goes, Eddie, you want to come out to lunch with us? You know, Steven Spielberg. I was 22 years old. I go, yeah, I'll go out the line. So it's Steven Spielberg, John Belushi, Dan Aykroyd, and me. We're in the commissary. I'm sitting there. I didn't say a word the whole... I'm sitting there, you know, my jaw's dropping. They said it. I didn't say a word for like an hour. And they're all talking, you know, and I'm looking like an idiot, you know. Then after lunch, I realized, I don't have any money. Oh, my God, I don't have any money. Luckily, Spielberg picked up the tab. He paid for it. But that was the greatest lunch of my life. Yeah.
Wow. That's some incredible company.
It was a cool lunch, yeah.
Damn.
Yeah.
I'm jealous.
Yeah.
Those are Belushi and Aykroyd. That's the Blues Brothers.
They were one. Both nice guys. John was the nicest guy. The last day I saw John Belushi, we were in Hollywood, and I was just walking down, and who's there? John Belushi comes up. I had just come out of an audition, and it was a bad audition. And he goes, "Hi, Eddie. How are you?" I go, "I just went to this audition, and I did terrible. They hated me." And he goes, "They're assholes." That was the last thing, and that was the last. And then he walked off. That was the last time I saw John Belushi. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. I love trivia, yeah. Right. Is that right? Oh, I didn't know that. Okay. I remember when I worked with him, he was really into ghosts. He's into the supernatural and ghosts and all that. He would go, "Eddie, they're for real. Eddie, they're really here." He was really into it. Yeah. But he was a really nice guy. Yeah.
Anyone else with any questions?
Thank you. Yes. Yeah, that was fun. Yeah. I was Mandark, the bad guy. Yeah. Mad scientist. Yeah. Yes, sir.
Were there any other Saturday morning type cartoons?
I did Johnny Bravo. I did Kim Possible. I used to do that one. I did Cow and Chicken. I did Powerpuff Girls. Like all those ones that the Cartoon Network, I used to do those.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
See, I feel like there's been somebody else out there in the same era who has a very similar voice, almost like he was stealing your thunder.
Maybe so. You know, you never know. Yeah.
You know, he's definitely trying to steal.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
So I was never sure.
Oh.
If it was you or not. I knew about Dexter's Lab.
Yeah.
I only watched a handful of episodes. And it didn't really get me at the time, but at the time I was grown. I was somewhat older. So, you know, you got to stop watching cartoons at some point.
Yeah.
And then you come back to them when you're older.
Well, maybe not. It depends. Yeah. Yeah.
Well.
Nope. I'm sorry? I did one with Homer Simpson. I did with Dan Castellaneta. We were Lee, Harvey, and Oswald. We were three criminals. And I was like Oswald, but we were three criminals, and it was one episode. But I remember we played Lee, Harvey, and Dan was one of them, and I was one. I was like Oswald. Yeah, yeah, yeah. He was Dexter's dad. The guy that played Johnny Bravo is a great guy. He played Dexter's dad on Dexter's Laboratory. So I knew him already. Yeah, yeah. Yeah, they were great shows. They were funny shows. Yeah.
All right. Well,
okay.
Eddie, thank you very much.
Yes.
Thank you for coming to Chatham.
It's been my pleasure. And thank you, everybody who came here. I really appreciate it. Thank you to the people at Chatham. I've never met such a nice group of people. It's not the biggest show I've ever been to, but I've never met a nicer group of people, I'll tell you that. These are wonderful, lovely people, and thank you all for coming.
Let's hear it for Eddie Deezen, folks.
Right. Thank you.